There is a place that is spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free, and things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Good evening and welcome back to everybody to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. Wanted to take a first couple of minutes of the show here with Tim and do a little reminiscing about our weekend trip that we just came back from the Queen Mary. I just want to say, Tim, we have got, as corny as it sounds, we love you, Chicago. It's like one of those rock and roll things, you know, that you talk about how great your listeners and the people that attend your functions are. But, man, what a fantastic group of people we had out at the Queen Mary.
Absolutely.
220 people. Everybody getting along, getting to know one another, accepting a lot of the people that were there solo into their little groups and just getting to know one another. We had some fantastic times ghost hunting. And I will say what's really exciting for us is that I guess over 50 people that went on the ghost hunt the second night with Chris Fleming heard Jackie, the little girl in the pool, actually sing and talk. Mm-hmm. They've caught it on video and audio. So when that becomes available, we'll put it up on our site, and I'll have some people send me some of their evidence from the trip, and we'll post it. So that way, those of you that couldn't make it could see some of the stuff that went on. But overall, it would be hard. I've gotten a ton of emails, people asking, what was your favorite part of the trip? I just had a great time the entire time. People were so awesome to hang out with, joking around. I guess, probably the fun part for me was after the first night when everybody was just kind of milling around and I came out in the duck pajamas to make Patrick Burns laugh. For those of you that weren't there, you'll see the pictures, I'm sure, eventually pop up. I have a big pair of footy pajamas with rubber duckies all over them. And if you go to my MySpace page, there's actually a video one of our listeners and friends made for me of me walking around in my ducky pajamas. So
it's the cutest thing ever. It really is.
So that was fun, and just the laughter and camaraderie and getting to go. Actually, I went ghost hunting with Grant that night, wearing my ducky footy pajamas. So
it keeps away the evil spirits.
That's what I've been told. So we went down to the pool. There's some funny pictures Grant took of me ghost hunting with my footy pajamas on. So, but the whole event was just a lot of fun, and we did, as you know, Tim, our first ever celebrity charity auction at this event. And I got to tell you, people, you are awesome. You helped raise $9,000 for charity at our event. For an hour-long auction, you raised $9,000. And we had some really fun stuff that we were able to bring in and make a part of the auction, so that made it really fun as well. But just, we also auctioned off, and we will be doing another auction at the Stanley event, which is coming up at the end of March. And I do want to make a comment. Tickets are on sale. We only have about 20 tickets left for the Stanley event, which takes place in Colorado at Estes Park, Colorado. The site of it's the hotel where Stephen King originally got his ideas and began to write the book, The Shining. So we went out there in November, had a fantastic time, had some really great experiences. Over 100 people that were on our trip had personal experiences of their own, saw things, got touched, got audio EVP. We're going to be going back out there with our guests, Jay and Grant, Chris Fleming, Patrick Burns, John Zaffis, Adam Bly, Rosemary Ellen Guiley, Jay Allen Danilek, and a host of others. We've got some really cool stuff going to happen. We're going to also have another auction. One of the items that we're going to be auctioning off is a private paranormal investigation with Jay and Grant, and a private paranormal investigation with Chris and Patrick. So there will be time after one of the main investigations, when everybody's gone and quiet and it's the middle of the night, that you guys get to go back out for another hour to hour and a half with the ghost hunters and go investigate with them. And the guys that won this last trip will tell you it was a lot of fun. It was a really cool item to get. Just a lot of fun stuff will be out there. Tim, how about you? What was your favorite part of the whole weekend, would you say? Besides molesting Denny the puppet.
That had to be my favorite.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we should probably explain. Russ Clark has a puppet he uses in his act.
Yes.
And His name is Denny. He's the cutest thing ever. And he's got this little, he's got little blonde hair and little blue eyes, and he was smiling at me the entire time. So I figured, you know, why not make a go of it? And
yes, so needless to say, there's a lot of really horrifying pictures of Tim that'll be floating around the internet dating this puppet. So, you know, keep your eyes out for that.
But I think we were doing a little more than dating.
That was a lot of fun hanging out with all those people, though. I mean, because that was like one night, 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, there was just 30 of us gathered in one of the halls and or in one of the meeting rooms, and we just all sat there and laughed. And Patrick Burns and Chris Fleming joined us, and Russ Clark, the hypnotist, the comedy hypnotist that was there, joined us. And I will tell you as well, on the Stanley trip, Russ Clark is joining us again. He won't be doing the comedy hypnosis show this time, but he will be on hand to do the really popular group therapy session, so that you can come in for a group hypnosis session on weight loss and on developing your ESP. The people that attended the last event at the Queen Mary did those events and loved it. Plus, when you do those, either the weight loss or the developing your ESP, you also get a copy of Russ's CD to take home with you, Hypnosis at Your Leisure, of losing weight and for the ESP. So it's a great value. It'll only be $40, and you get to go in for a session with Russ, and you get the CD. So it's a really good value on that. The CDs usually go for, I think, like $25 to $40 anyway. So you get a heck of a value and a live event to do as well. So, well, with that said, I don't want to take too much time away from our guests this evening, and we've got a couple of really great guests coming up. But I do want to thank everybody that made it out to the event. You made it really special for Tim and I, and I know the guys from the Ghost Hunters and everything else are really enjoying it. And I do want to make one more quick mention. There are a lot of new trips that are popping up from different shows, from different paranormal groups. There's still only one Darkness Radio event. If it does not bear the Darkness Radio Presents or Darkness Radio logo, it is we are not part of their event. We are not responsible for anything that goes on their events. So make sure that if you're looking to attend our events, that you make sure you're signing up for the right ones. And I will tell you that we are just finishing off the negotiation, and it looks like either May or June, we are definitely going to be doing our next trip to Eastern State Penitentiary with Jason and Grant, Chris Fleming, and Steve Gonzalez. We're also working on a couple other really cool guests for the event. So it'll be Jay, Grant, and Steve from Ghost Hunters, and Chris Fleming from the TV show Dead Famous will be joining us, and we'll have a great time. So keep in mind, keep watching our site, darknessradio.com/trips. And, you know, if you went to any of the trips and you want to discuss and hang out with other people on the boards that took advantage of the trip, please go over to our website at darknessradio.com and click on the Discuss tab, and it'll take you in there. And just look around, meet some other great people.
And just remember, Dave, like Dave said, ain't no party like a darkness party, because a darkness party don't stop.
That's what I say.
That's right. Anything else is just an imitation.
That's right. Yep. Well, no, I'm sure there's some other really great trips that are going to be going on out there, but I get people emailing me going, oh, yeah, we're looking forward to doing that Lizzie Borden trip with you. And I'm like, oh, that's Ron and Wheezy trips, not me. Well, we're looking forward to doing this. Oh, that's that radio show, not ours. Well, we're looking, you know, ours will say Darkness Radio Presents on it, so you know. But we'll get into our guest here this evening, and our first guest for the evening is Michelle Belanger, and she discovered her psychic abilities at an early age. She's been deeply involved with the vampire community since the early 1990s. She's also edited and published the gothic literary magazine Shadow Dance, and is a member of the Chicago-based band Urn. She's written numerous books, two of which we're going to talk about tonight that really interested me. The first book is called The Psychic Vampire Codex, A Manual of Magic and Energy Work, and Psychic Dreamwalking, Explorations at the Edge of Self. Well, we'd like to welcome you to the show. Good evening, Michelle.
Hey, Dave.
How are you?
In sort of shameless plug, because your Stanley Hotel event sounds great. That whole group of people is exactly why I've been poking around on the internet to find you guys again.
Oh, great.
Yeah. UniFCon with you guys.
Right.
Just your listeners, that is a fun group of people to hang out with. You will absolutely enjoy yourself, so I highly recommend it.
Well, thank you. Yeah, UniFCon was a lot of fun. They're going to be doing that again this year, and we'll be posting some information about that as soon as tickets become available, and that's out in Penn State College, Pennsylvania, and it's a really fun time. You get a lot of great speakers and everything going on, so that will be taking place. But yeah, Michelle, we'll have to have you out on one of these events as we're going along and have you come out and do a talk for us as well.
Oh, it sounds like a great time. I'd definitely be up for it. I remember a lot of people go, okay, you're into psychic vampires, but you're a psychic too?
Yeah.
I'm like, well, you know, if I'm going to feed off of psychic energy, I would hope I could sense it, because otherwise I would be up shit creek without a paddle.
No doubt. Well, let's talk about your first book that I wanted to talk about was your book, The Psychic Vampire Codex. Why don't you give me a background a little bit about the book, and then let's talk a little bit about you and your interest in the vampire culture.
Okay. The book is a two-parter. It is intended to give somebody who is completely unaware of any idea of vampirism some background, not just in the concept of psychic vampires, but in the concept that some people identify as a psychic vampire in a positive way by becoming aware of it and have even like kind of formed a community. Sometimes it sort of started as a support group of, oh my God, does this happen to you too?
Right.
And the second half of it is a manual of energy work that actually had been circulated throughout that community since sometime in the 90s. I'd started writing it in 91 and had become kind of a cult text for the psychic vampires to teach them how to use their powers for good, basically.
Okay.
Coming to understand how psychic vampirism works, why some people are vampiric naturally, and then how to control the way you interact with energy so that you do not take from people without their permission.
All right, so you can do that? You can be leeching without... Can you leech without knowing that you're leeching?
The vast majority of psychic vampires have no idea that they are psychic vampires, and everybody has one in their life. It's either that really annoying guy at the office who just needs to get up in your face and, like, tell you about his day and his bunions and his dog at home, and just he goes on and on and on and on and on and gets up in your space, and by the time you're done, because you're trying to extricate yourself from this conversation, mm-hmm. you feel headachy and drained. We have relatives like this. Sometimes they're a little bit more than, you know, the oh, woe is me sort of people that get up in your face and provoke a strong emotional reaction, and they seem to really feed off of that emotional reaction. They don't necessarily understand what it is they're taking from you, but those are psychic vampires. They're the bad sort of psychic vampire because they take from people without any kind of consent. And consensually, people interact with energy all the time. Whenever we have a conversation, there's some exchange. But in general, a psychic vampire is typified by the fact that there is more energy being taken than given.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this. Now, you're mentioning psychic vampires. Most people that are familiar with vampire lore are familiar with what they call, is it sanguine?
Yeah, sanguine vampires.
And those are the type that drink blood?
Yes, they do.
Okay, so what you do is not feeding off of blood, you're feeding off of energy. Now, let me ask you, though, I mean, you know, kind of begs the question. As you said, we all have people like that in our lives. Is it really that they're just a psychic vampire, or are they just a pain in our ass? I mean, is it just somebody who's really irritating, and you just being around them just wears you out? Does that really have something to do with them leeching off of your energy, or does it have to do with just your energy being expelled just trying to get through the conversation? I mean, is there a difference between those two?
There is a fine line. The best way of figuring out if, well, a person themselves is a psychic vampire is if somehow their health on some level really seems to revolve around that taking that energy. Because there are plenty of people who are pains in the butt, and they just seem to thrive on it on an emotional level. A psychic vampire, as I've defined in the book, is somebody who needs to regularly and actively take this energy in order to maintain their own physical, mental, or spiritual well-being. So this is somebody who will decline without that kind of an interaction.
Okay, so they're actually feeding their own life force.
Yeah, it's actually kind of a proactive, you know, you use Reiki and Qigong, you use energy to heal people. This is sort of a proactive self-healing, but it tends to be somewhat obnoxious when the person doesn't know what they're doing.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, yeah, that's what I, you know, I mean, this is all kind of new to me. I mean, I grew up wanting to be a vampire myself, and, yeah, as silly as that sounds, I used to actually take my mom's emery board and file my, my canine teeth to try to make them sharp because I wanted to be a vampire when I grew up. You know, and of course I stopped that, you know, 3 or 4 months ago, but anyway, you know, had that ability. I will say that, you know, I've always felt that, you know, akin to it just because I am a creature of the night. I don't like daylight. I don't like being out in the day. I don't, you know, but then, you know, reality check comes in and I kind of feel like a goof for, you know, feeling part of that. Do you feel that a lot of the vampire subculture that's going on is just, you know, a skater group, a punk group, support group for just other people that have the same interest? Do you really feel that vampirism is as prevalent as it is in the real world? Or do you think it's just kind of people that like to wear black and hang out at night and wear creepy makeup? Oop, I may have lost you. I'm
maybe 10% are actually...
You know, I apologize, Michelle. You dropped out on us altogether there. We lost all the audio on you. What was that?
If I had to be honest, I would say perhaps 10% of the people involved in the vampire subculture are actually vampiric.
Okay.
The vast majority of people are what we call lifestylers, like you were when you were younger. They are romanced by an archetype. The vampire is a very compelling archetype, and it has wormed its way in pop culture. And it's something that a lot of people find appealing because, I mean, it's a sexy, powerful, immortal thing. Who wouldn't want to kind of identify with that?
Right.
Especially if you're kind of more of a night person. So mm-hmm. The vast majority of people in the vampire subculture are what we refer to as lifestylers. They like the idea of dressing up and being a vampire, but they are not vampiric. On the other side of things, a lot of people who are vampiric, who are psychic vampires, aren't even into that. They don't do the dress-up thing. They don't go hang out at goth clubs. And actually, they have a kind of overall distaste for it because it's somewhat offensive to see people dressing up and pretending to be something that you have to deal with every day as a reality.
Okay. Well, I guess that would be a good way to lead in with the next part. If there are people that are truly vampiric, now, are there, in your opinion, are there real sanguine vampires out there, not just goofballs that like to cut each other and drink each other's blood, but I mean real people that live off of blood.
They do not live exclusively off of blood. Mm-hmm. The sanguines who I know and I take seriously are people who use the blood as a focal point really for the life energy that they're taking. Don Henry, a friend of mine who mm-hmm. was on Sci-Fi's Mad Mad House, he identifies as both Psi and Sang, which is to say that most of the time he's taking energy and just energy, but every once in a while as more of a kind of intense, focused exchange with somebody who's very special in his life, he'll take a small amount of blood as a carrier for the energy. He's got a really great way of kind of explaining how that works to people. He takes a piece of paper and he writes energy on it, and he hands you the piece of paper, and he says the paper is the blood, and it's carrying the message, the energy.
Okay, so you think it's more just a token?
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, I mean, so many Native Americans believe that when you killed an animal, if you were to drink its blood,
you would get its power.
Right. That is that what most of them are trying to do? Is just kind of absorbing somebody that they care and love? Is that what their intent is?
Yeah, in a lot of cases. Now there are some people who claim to have an actual physical need for some physical thing in the blood. And they've actually been working to try to get taken seriously enough to have medical tests run to see if there is anything going on. Lady CG up in Canada and a couple of others are proponents of that. I'm not sure what I think about that. I'm actually, as weird as my life is, something of a skeptic, and I really do like to put things to the test. And if there's any way to run a test on something, then do it.
Sure.
My struggle to accept the psychic vampirism has been underscored by weird experiences. A&E was kind enough to actually show something like this. I do have an effect on energy, and not just like people's energy, but electrical energy. So I will drain batteries. I'll interfere with cameras and the functionality of the equipment for any of the filming and stuff. The History Channel got to do some fun stuff with Kirlian photography, and that was all kinds of fun. So there's something weird.
Was that the show that they did with Don Henry and Rosemary Ellen Guiley about a year or so ago?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. All right. And was that the one, were you the psychic vampire that had the girl with you and you were feeding off of her?
Yep, that would be me.
All right.
Because they always put me on camera with a girl.
All right.
I guess because they assume that that's not, everybody likes girls.
Well, I won't deny that.
Well, I'm not even really sure. Either that or it's just, I just haven't quite figured it out. If they film me, they always have me feeding off of
sure,
a girl.
It's more sexual to see you doing something with a female, and that's sex
sells. Inevitably doing the kind of like the hands-on stuff that you do for the energy work, there is a sexual charge to the way it looks, so yeah.
Do you feel that, you know, in doing it's got to be hard for people that know you and you know, are friends with you on a regular basis. I mean, do you get a lot of people who just think you're a nut?
Oddly, no.
Okay.
I mean, I live in a small town in Medina and, in Ohio,
mm-hmm.
a little town called Medina, and the vast majority of people are like, when they find out about it, they're like, you know, I've always had, suddenly they start telling me about their own experiences. rather not necessarily even vampire related, but just that there is something bigger to the world, that people are aware of something. I mean, spirits, all of it kind of boils down to energy. If a ghost exists, it is, you know, the energetic echo, it is the spirit part of a person that is lingering beyond the physical body. That's this numinous something that can't always be measured. So to propose that somebody has a special sensitivity to that energy, that's just saying that they're psychic. And it's just one step past that to go on the idea that, okay, we interchange with this energy, we work with it all the time. Some people are more sensitive to it than others, and some people can harness it to heal, some people can harness it to take.
Do you, as somebody that's in the vampire culture and fancy yourself a vampire, can you sense other vampires, other people that are like this? I mean, is it...
There really is a type of vampire gaydar,
okay.
as cheesy as it is. First I have to say that the word vampire is just the best word we have in the English language for someone who takes life. And a lot of us wear it very uncomfortably. I took a long time to make peace with the idea of being a vampire.
I think there is another word out there, and it might be mother-in-law. Just kidding, mother-in-laws. That's a joke. You're all lovely people.
Lovely, lovely people. That's right. Yeah, you need a couple of Tylenol when you're done with the visit.
So, but it's not really the vampire. I guess it's hard for me to wrap my head around. I mean, like I said, it's been just such a romanticized thing my whole life. But I will admit that there are people that I've been around that. I will physically feel ill after they've left, like I've just gone through the ringer, and they seem like they're perfectly fine, and sometimes they almost seem like they're better after they walk away than when they started talking to me.
If they seem that they're doing better after you start feeling like crap, that's probably a good sign that they're getting something out of the exchange more than just irritating you with their whatever it is they're irritating you with.
Yeah, that's right, Tim. I'm looking at you.
One of the things that's hard for people is because there is so much crossover between the romanticized image of the vampire and people who identify as vampiric. The best explanation I can have for this is, as you're growing up with special abilities, special awarenesses, our culture doesn't have a whole lot of context for that, and you kind of try to figure out where you can put yourself. We need labels in a lot of ways to sort of conceptualize something in our lives. Some of the people I know who are psychic, growing up, coming to terms with that, identified as witches, and you know now they're pagans and Wiccans. Or you're a spirit medium because that's more widely known. You end up with people, you know, kind of identifying with the ghost whisperer, or like, you know, really getting in with Chris and identifying with Chris. So it's okay to be a spirit medium, but that gives you a word.
Right.
But when you're growing up, there's nobody on TV, and there's really not many books of somebody like, well, you know, I take energy, so I call myself a, you know, whatever. All you have is the folklore, the stories of somebody who can, you know, has this mesmerizing presence and can take energy from someone, usually through the medium of blood, and then you kind of end up with this struggle of, okay, but I don't drink blood, so what the heck am I?
Gotcha. Well, I mean, the original lore, it wasn't really blood that vampires drank anyway, wasn't it? It was other bodily fluids and...
A whole variety of things, right. Actually. Blood was kind of what people presumed was going on, even if they didn't have actual sign of blood being taken, because, of course, you go back to the book of Leviticus, the blood is the life.
Mm-hmm.
And the concept to that is actually the type of life energy we're talking about. The whole idea behind the kosher laws, where you're supposed to let the blood spill out of the animal before you actually eat the flesh, was the blood contained the spirit, the life that belonged to God. And man was not good enough to eat that. He could only eat the flesh, because man was flesh.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what. Let's take a quick break, Michelle. We'll be right back. We'll talk more with you and learn a little bit more about your book and psychic dreamwalking. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. We'll be back right after this.
We thought El Chupacabra meant the cup of coffee in Spanish.
Mi amo Eduardo Especial. ¿Cómo está el yay?
What you talking about, Willis?
Shows you what we know. Stay tuned. There's more to come from the Darkness on the Edge of Town.
For 58 years, Fate has consistently supplied its loyal readership with a broad array of true reports of the strange and unknown. Fate is a factual magazine containing articles by experts in all walks of life, and by others just like you who have something dynamic, significant, and truthful to say. Keep up with the latest on angels and miracles, psychic phenomena, ghosts, UFOs, archaeological hotspots, alternative science, and much, much more. To receive your free Fate magazine, Call now at 1-800-728-2730 or visit our website at www.fatemag.com. That's 1-800-728-2730 or www.fatemag.com. What are you waiting for? Your fate awaits.
Are you tired of reading about what couple in Hollywood is breaking up or divorcing? Have you ever wondered where you can find the news that covers the subjects that you are really interested in? I would like to invite you to visit SupernaturalNews.com. Supernatural News uses the latest internet technology to search for the topics we know you will be interested in reading. News of the latest Bigfoot, UFO, or Loch Ness Monster sightings. Read about the latest conspiracy theories and urban legends. Supernatural News, where belief and reality merge.
They're hardly beautiful and barely average. In fact, when they were both born, the doctor slapped their moms instead of them.
I will slap you so hard you end up in the Ming Dynasty.
Welcome back to the darkness on the edge of town with Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis.
Good evening and welcome back to the show. Now make sure that you do check out ghoststock.com. That's GHOSTOCK.com and go visit Patrick Burns and Steve Gonzalez as they investigate Savannah, Georgia. It's going to be amazing. They've got a great lineup of speakers. They've got a fantastic bunch of stuff going on, so you want to go check it out. Patrick is a hell of a performer, and you can see him on Haunting Evidence on Court TV. And, of course, Steve Gonzalez you recognize from the TV show Ghost Hunters. So please go check out the website again at ghoststock.com. We're going to get back into our show this evening. Our guest is Michelle Belanger, and she's the author of two books that are sitting in front of me right here I'd like to talk about, The Psychic Vampire Codex and Psychic Dreamwalking, Explorations at the Edge of Self. There are other books that she has written. We'll have her back on to talk about those as well, but I'd kind of like to talk a little bit more about these. Let's wrap up real quickly, Michelle, so we can talk about the other book too. The idea behind The Psychic Vampire Codex, what exactly are you sharing with the reader in this book?
The experience of psychic vampires. And the idea behind ethical practices of psychic vampirism, so that if you are somebody who does seem to need to supplement your regular energy with the energy of others, you can do it in a fashion that is not, well, it doesn't make you a universal pain in the neck.
Okay. How would we go about that? If I'm running low on energy, I'm doing these conventions and shows, and there are times, man, I just don't even know how I survive. I just keep moving and moving and moving. How can I draw off of somebody else? You know, and will I actually feel a difference?
Well, you probably, when you're up on stage and you've got the attention of the entire audience, there's a rush that comes along with that.
Sure.
Every actor knows about it, and every actor knows when you've got the audience not giving you energy because it's a real drain to be up there, and you start just feeling like crap. Easiest thing is to interact with somebody who is vibrant and, you know, emotionally engaged in what you are talking to them about. You can do it one-on-one, you can do it with an audience, and just kind of cycle that energy between you and that person. So, you know, you're putting forth the effort to continue to get their emotional interest and their attention, and then you're taking that energy, that attention into yourself.
Isn't that more like an endorphin or adrenaline rush? Is that really coming from the audience, or is it just, I mean, because that's from the body you're secreting. You're excited to be up there. You're nervous. The body's kicking out these chemicals. Is that really coming from the audience, or am I doing it myself?
Both.
Okay.
If first thing that we learn in theater is that there really is an energy between you and the audience that you're interacting with.
Mm-hmm.
And that, yes, there's endorphins. There are very physical things going on. But there is something, some other numinous substance that is passing back and forth. And you really do notice it the most when you have an audience or a person who just shuts down, who's not giving you anything back, because the experience is totally different.
All right. Now, is there a way one-on-one? I mean, you're teaching basically in this book how not to be a leech, right?
Yes.
How not to just suck people dry without them knowing about it, how to interact and be able to do this and be a good sucker of energy. Is that correct?
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay. What would be, you know, just if you can give us just one little tip or two little tips here on the best ways to go about that. I know you just kind of said for me being on stage and things like that, but for people that aren't in that, what else can they do?
One-on-one with another person, the energy rides on the breath. You can reinforce the connection with physical touch, but you don't have to. But you're focused on the other person and literally breathing in their energy. Ideally, you don't want to do this to somebody who's not willing and not consenting, for a couple of reasons, but the consent also allows them to drop their barriers and their shields to allow to offer this back up to you. Techniques that you're taught in yoga, pranayama, the breathing, the conscious, intentional breathing of energy from the environment around you, you're just doing that with another person, physically, hands-on with the person. It's the same as Reiki, only in reverse. Rather than putting energy in, you're pulling the energy out. Usually, it helps to kind of reinforce this with breathing in. And you'll feel your hands start to tingle. You'll feel a kind of tingling between you and the person, and not just because you're happy to see them.
Okay. All right.
And sometimes they will notice an exchange of you'll grow warmer, they'll grow cooler. That's probably the most physical notation that people have made a comment on for a successful transfer of energy. Christine Wicker, another author who was a skeptic, actually a Southern Baptist, studying all the weird paranormal stuff. That was the one thing that she really felt, was suddenly she'd gotten very cold.
Okay. I think we have a question from the chat room, Tim. Do we have somebody popping in there?
Yeah, we have Rosemary Ellen Guiley, who's actually in the chat room right now, and she wants to know, Michelle, she's read your book with great interest and would like to know more on how you came to channel the Codex and what sources that you feel connected to. By sources, she means the non-physical sources of the Codex.
Okay. A lot of it is past life stuff. Again, being someone who's skeptical, that was sort of weird to come completely to terms with as well, but that's a whole other show. But I had been talking about past lives and my past lives to my mom before I was 3. And then reading widely to verify the impressions that I had. I started off with, it seemed like, a lot of knowledge that didn't seem to have anything to do with anything I'd been taught in school. And again, I came at it from the perspective of a skeptic. It was pretty weird stuff. You know, this whole idea that there's this other stuff, this energy, and, you know, it's more than the physical world. I got to say, you know, a magna cum laude graduate of a pretty prestigious private university and a National Merit Scholar, you know, on the fast track to becoming a professor, this is weird stuff to be getting into,
mm-hmm.
And certainly not anything that's going to earn you tenure, you know?
Sure. Well, not to brag, but Tim and I graduated from that Sally Struthers Correspondence School of Veterinary and Air Conditioning. So I can remove a dog's spleen while fixing your hoses and stuff and filling up your air conditioning vents. So.
That's great.
And, you know, I think I got that from my past life, too.
So you
basically channeled that from your past lives. You feel that's stuff that you had learned from there.
The energy work was stuff that I had learned from there. And the practical application of it and grounding it into, I studied a lot of Hindu, Taoist. Most of the Eastern religions take the existence of energy pretty much for granted. They're where most of our words for it come from, prana, chi, ki. And from a scholarly standpoint, what I really sought to do was figure out if I was crazy or if there were at least other people who thought this way.
That you were crazy? Did you find other people that thought you were crazy?
What I was surprised to find was that there were ancient traditions and even modern traditions where energy was a reality. And to go from that notion that there is energy that we exchange with the environment, that we exchange with one another, it wasn't too much of a stretch to go, okay, some people need it more than others. A lot of people who are psychic vampires have chronic health problems. To give you an idea, I was born with a pretty much a fatal heart defect and had two near-death experiences before the age of 5. In a lot of respects, I'm hale and hearty because of the energy that I take from consenting donors. When I don't do that, and this was my test in college, I really do get myself very, very sick. It hits my heart and my heart rhythm first, and to a rather alarming degree. I'm probably a lot healthier than someone with an experimental surgery and a piece of Teflon in their heart probably should be. But that's purely because I do this. If I don't do it, I start to feel the fact that my body's really not all that.
Well, that makes sense, too. Yeah, you know, and it's interesting that you say that because I notice it, you know, and I'll be the first one to call myself out on this, that, you know, I wonder, then if I am a form of psychic vampire, and I'm sure there's probably plenty of people out there that'd be willing to say, hell yeah.
Well, yeah.
There's one. But if it's, you know, because, you know, again, like that, I did grow up with a lot of health problems. I still have a lot of health problems. And, you know, it seems that there's always some kind of conflict going on in my life. And I don't know if that's the energy. You know, so many people say you know, people that always need a crisis in order to feel better. And I'm wondering if that's the case, you know, because it always seems that way. There's always something popping up that's kind of a bit of a crisis. So if that's the case, could it just be that I'm leeching the energy from the crisis, and without it, that's when I feel the most weak or worn down?
That is a pretty classic description of a psychic vampire who doesn't know that they are one. I mean, I'll be perfectly honest to you.
Okay.
Because heightened emotion, good, bad, or otherwise, negative mm-hmm. emotions are good, too. It gets people's energy really pumping. It gets, on a physical level, all of their endorphins running, it gets all of the adrenaline going, and body follows energy, energy follows body. So as the body gets into a heightened state, they're also putting out more energy. You can't take one without the other. You have to look at them as both. They're part of the same thing constantly.
Could you know, even like extreme anger or
anger,
humor, I mean, you know, the yes. joking and stuff like that, leeching off of that, is that all part of it, in your opinion?
In my opinion, all of those things kind of go together. The worst part of psychic vampires who don't know what they are, they're the really dramatic people who are always causing problems around them and just kind of getting everybody around them agitated and for no apparent reason beyond just kind of basking in that. And that's where you end up with the fairly negative attitudes towards psychic vampires, because they can sometimes be really obnoxious people.
Okay. And then now, so people that are looking for help or feel that they may be a psychic vampire, just not sure how to control it, your book will help them to understand how to do this and
in a lot of ways,
get more of their life back in control?
Yeah. In a lot of ways, I wrote it to honestly save other people from the struggles I went through of trying to figure out, okay, am I crazy? What's going on with this? How does it work? I made a lot of mistakes in the process of learning how not... learning the worst ways to take energy from people by doing them, unfortunately.
Okay. Well, that makes sense. Well, I'll tell you what we'll do for the readers, too, and we'll have you back on in the future. And I apologize, I didn't get a chance to read the Psychic Vampire Codex yet. I was more into the Psychic Dreamwalking book myself. But I'll tell you what, I will go through that book from cover to cover myself and start implementing the things that you recommend in there and see if I do notice a change in my life and the things that are going on and the powers or things that I'm draining myself. And then maybe we can have you back on in the future and kind of talk about the results either way.
Hey, that's cool. As good I said, point. I'm always good about putting things to the test.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what, we're going to take another quick break, and you're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guest is Michelle Belanger, and her next book we're going to talk a little bit about is Psychic Dreamwalking, Explorations at the Edge of Self. We'll be back with more of that right after this.
The New York Times has raved about the show. The Star Tribune says it's paranormally funny, and the Biscayne Bugle said, how could they put this crap on the air and live with themselves?
I am so, so sorry for everything that has happened. Because in spite of what Mike says now, it is my fault. Because it was my project. Everything had to be my way. And this is where we've ended up.
Stay tuned. There's more to come from the darkness on the edge of town.
To use the words of Mary Thompson, there is no greater pain than the loss of a loved one. So many things you never thought you would have to do, so many decisions you never thought you would have to face. Mary describes the painful journey of losing her husband to a chronic illness in her new book, With Angels Beside Me, A Caregiver's Story. With Angels Beside Me not only takes you through Mary's struggles, but also serves as a guide to caregivers everywhere that are looking to find peace, guidance, and hope in their own situations. With Angels Beside Me, A Caregiver's Story is available right now at Amazon.com. Just search for the title on Amazon or for Mary herself. With Angels Beside Me is only $9.95 and available to ship anywhere around the world. If you know someone who's losing a loved one, or if you yourself are facing some sort of loss of a family member, be sure to read Mary Thompson's With Angels Beside Me, A Caregiver's Story. Available right now on Amazon.com.
Hi, this is Patrick Burns, founder and director of Ghost Hounds, Paranormal Investigators Network, and co-star of Court TV series Haunting Evidence. I'd like to invite you to join us this February 1st through the 4th at Savannah, Georgia's Hilton DeSoto Hotel for Ghost Stock 4, our spirited weekend of spirits. We've planned 4 days packed full of activities, including exclusive after-hours private investigations to Savannah's haunted landmarks. Our special guest for this event is TAP's ghost hunter Steve Gonzalez, who will deliver our keynote speech at the event and be signing autographs throughout the weekend. This is a great chance to hang out with one of today's most respected and sought-after paranormal investigators. Please join us and find out for yourself why the American Institute of Parapsychology calls Savannah the most haunted city in America. Event tickets are just $49.95 for individuals and $89.95 for couples. Please visit us at ghoststock.com, ghostock.com, to pre-register for what promises to be another amazing weekend. Hope to see you in Savannah this February for Ghost Stock 4.
For 58 years, Fate has consistently supplied its loyal readership with a broad array of true reports of the strange and unknown. Fate is a factual magazine containing articles by experts in all walks of life, and by others just like you who have something dynamic, significant, and truthful to say. Keep up with the latest on angels and miracles, psychic phenomena, ghosts, UFOs, archaeological hotspots, alternative science, and much, much more. To receive your free Fate magazine, call now at 1-800-728-2730 or visit our website at www.fatemag.com. That's 1-800-728-2730 or www.fatemag.com. What are you waiting for? Your fate awaits.
Hi, this is Russ Clark. If you're a regular listener of Darkness Radio, by now you have certainly heard my radio commercial regarding my hypnosis products. Well, I'm here today to tell you that these products work. These products have worked for many, many people, including some listeners of Darkness Radio. I stand behind my product 100%. If you give it a try and you find it doesn't work for you, you can always return it to me for 100% of your money back. Plus, I'll pay to ship it back to me. That's how convinced I am this will work for you. In addition to that, you can contact me via email anytime with any questions that you may have. I promise this will work for you. So if you want to quit smoking, lose weight, become less stressed, manage some pain, or beat some insomnia, definitely check out my website at www.powerhypnosis.net or call 866-570-3544 and ask for me personally.
Are you tired of reading about what couple in Hollywood is breaking up or divorcing? Have you ever wondered where you can find the news that covers the subjects that you are really interested in? I would like to invite you to visit SupernaturalNews.com. Supernatural News uses the latest internet technology to search for the topics we know you will be interested in reading. News of the latest Bigfoot, UFO, or Loch Ness Monster sightings. Read about the latest conspiracy theories and urban legends. Supernatural News, where belief and reality merge.
Two ghosts walk into a bar and see another ghost at the bar point at them and yell, "Boo!" One of the ghosts yells back, "Boo hoo!" And the ghost at the bar yells back, "Well, you don't have to cry about it." Ah, hell, you try writing this.
You magnificent bastard! I salute you!
Welcome back to the darkness on the edge of town.
Hey, welcome back to the show. Thank you very much for joining Tim and I here on the Darkness on the Edge of Town every Sunday night from 10 to midnight Central Time. And if you can't stay up late to listen to the whole show, you can download it. We'll have it up on the website by tomorrow morning, so that way it's there and available for you to download.
Is that your phone?
No, not my phone, man. I think we're getting a call from God. That's pretty loud. That's creepy weird.
Oh, God, is that you?
Going on our show this evening, we have our guest is Michelle Belanger, and she's the author of The Psychic Vampire Codex and also Psychic Dreamwalking, Explorations at the Edge of Self. And I'd like to talk a little bit more about that book now, Michelle, if you've got a little bit of time here. We've got about 12, 15 minutes left on the show. Psychic Dreamwalking, give me an explanation from you. What exactly do you describe it to be?
Psychic dreamwalking is the intersection between out-of-body experience and lucid dreaming.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout history, there have been instances where people, very ordinary people, will have a dream of a loved one that comes to say goodbye to them, only to find that the next day that person has passed away. It's usually somebody who's at a distance and would not have been able to contact them any other way save the dream. These are common enough experiences that people have postulated whether or not it is telepathy or an actual visitation. In some cases, you can kind of conclude that actually the spirit has come to you because the contact happens after death. But there are instances where it's recorded to to have occurred before death. So that it seems to point toward an innate human ability to reach out on some level beyond physical communication. Sigmund Freud himself had enough experience with dreams, wrote the landmark work, Interpretation of Dreams, in 1900, that he, as much of a skeptic as he was throughout most of his life, suggested that dreams were the most likely place for us to have proof of paranormal and telepathic abilities. In the 60s, two doctors, Ullman and Krippner, were doing a great deal of work in the Maimonides Dream Institute on dream telepathy. And psychic dream walking takes all of these ideas a step further, and much as you'll see this as a theme with my work, is taking an unconscious ability, an instinctual ability, and moving it into the realm of conscious recollection so that you can control it, so that you can learn how to reach out to people that you are close to and communicate within the realm of dreams.
All right. See, now that's interesting, very interesting to me, because I've always been, since I can remember, I've been able to control a lot of my dreams. And I've had communications with people through my dreams. Tim's actually the one of the two of us more that does more of the communication with spirits after they pass on in dream form. I've only had it really occur to me once. But I have spoken to friends or relatives in dreams that we seem to share it as a shared memory later. But it's something that never actually physically happened.
Yeah, and those instances where I wanted to figure out how do you control it, because it was clear that it was happening, and I had had, it really does happen with people that you're really close to, and there's some sort of communication, and sometimes it's a very ordinary, mundane communication. I mean, you just end up sitting around the table having a conversation about, you know, just regular life stuff, and yet you did not physically sit around a table and have the conversation. Still, you remember having the conversation. Both of you remember the content of it. Spirits fairly commonly will communicate with people in the dream space. And actually, one of the experiences I had while writing the book was my grandfather berating me for not using his keyboard that he left to me, and asking me very specifically to play a song for him called Give Me Back My Heart Again. And I just didn't even believe that this was a real song. I'd never heard of it. And it turned out to be exactly as he described, a piece for voice and piano that was written tail end of the 1800s. So the book is in some parts a resource on what dreams and dreaming are. It looks into the idea behind lucid dreaming, but also the idea behind REM sleep and the psychological repercussions of dreams. Part of my school background is in psychology, so you'll get a lot of Freud and Jung in there.
Sure.
I like to balance that out with the more esoteric aspects of things, because there are a lot of things that do come down to psychology, and I think that you should always consider that before you go leaping into a psychic explanation. But the bulk of the book is how you learn to control your dreams, achieve lucid dreaming, or harness the state between sleeping and waking, the borderline state, as you're just kind of dropping off, to launch yourself into this type of contact. In a conscious, controllable, and ultimately verifiable fashion.
Well, if I could ask you, let me ask, I've had two experiences that were extremely strange in dreams. One I'm not prepared to talk about yet. I'm still working out for myself.
Yeah, kind of like me, like where I got stuff from the Codex, I'll
right.
be honest.
Now, but the other one was, and I've still had no explanation for this, it was during my youth, when I was about 17, I had somebody in my life that was very... for lack of a better term, evil. And in one of my dreams that I dealt with, which I fly in most times, I'm able to fly. And he was in this dream and actually morphed into a demon-like creature. And I kept trying to leap over him as he was stabbing at me with a knife. And you know how dreams are. Your feet get stuck in the tar. Or you can't do it. Every time I jumped, I kept getting lower and lower, closer to him, and I couldn't get away, but it was a very small room, and it was, I was just doing my best to stay away from the knife. And at the one point, he stabs straight up with me and catches me, and it hurt like hell. I woke up to find a gash on my side and blood on my shirt. Now, we've all heard the term, oh, you die in your dreams, you die in real life. There's nobody that I think could prove that, because you can't come back and say, yeah, I was dreaming about dying when I died. But, what, if anything, what, from a psychic realm and from your own personal beliefs, I searched my bed to make sure that there was no knife there, there was nothing, you know, sharp in my bed, a spring or something that might have caught me. There was nothing there. What in God's name happened to me?
I devote an entire chapter to that, because the first thing is to do exactly what you did. Try to see if there was something that possibly caused it. Because one very typical dream phenomenon is we do not become completely insensitive to our environment when we sleep. We actually hear things, and you've all had the thing where, like, your alarm is going off, but you're dreaming about a foghorn or something, because you're interpreting that through the dream. You're hearing it, and it has to be symbolized somehow in the dream because the stimulus is there. The first thing to check is, okay, was there something in your bed that scratched you? When you have exhausted all of those options and you are still baffled beyond belief, there are definite instances where the realm between dreams and reality really is a lot hazier. Particularly, it sounds like this person committed a psychic attack. I don't like to jump to those conclusions and go absolutely definitely, but the possibility is there that the symbolic interaction that you were engaged in the dream, on some psychic level was real, and it was real enough to have a very physical impact.
All right. Well, I know that, there, you know, psychologists believe, and you're much more learned than I am, that, you know, mental can actually cause physical manifestations. They've seen scratches appear. Could it have just been that the dream was that intense for me that it could have caused an opening on my side?
That is another possibility. The idea that our basically mind over matter, our brains, if we believe something strongly enough, we can create a great deal of very physical repercussions. Now, in my experience, if somebody is psychosomatically convinced that there is some part of their body that has been harmed, they're more likely to end up with what would almost look like an allergic reaction, a rash or something, rather than an open cut. But the line between those two, between you thinking yourself into having this happen and it possibly happening at somebody else's will at a district, that line is very, very thin. And in my opinion, the only person who's really qualified to determine which it was is the person who experienced it, because they're the only one who has all of the facts.
All right. Now, do you believe that this is a form? I don't know if you remember the cool 1980s Dennis Quaid movie.
Heck yeah, I remember that.
Right, Dreamscape. I mean, is this what you believe it is, kind of a form of Dreamscape? Do you believe that occurs, where you can enter each other's dreams and communicate this way? Or do you believe that it's actually more of another dimension coffee house, if you will, you're all able to sit around and kind of talk and do you guys are all meeting elsewhere, or do you believe that you're actually coming into each other's dreams?
Literally in one another's heads.
Right.
I'll be honest, by the end of the book and all the study that I did with shamanism, where, you know, you are going into like a dream time kind of alternate reality, or if you take it from a Jungian perspective, you're going internally to an internal reality, there was evidence for both. That the best I could say is that these lines between us are very, very hazy. That on one hand, you might be entering one another's subconscious through a very vivid type of telepathy that does seem to have sometimes physical repercussions, or there is some external place that isn't really a place but is still a mental place that we can travel to, that seems to infringe upon the realm of spirits as well. Harkening back to the Greek method of dream incubation, which seems to have a lot to do with the same sort of thing, they believed that you would be able to contact the gods and you'd be able to interact with spirits and with the dead by entering dreams in certain controlled circumstances.
Now, are there ways for us to protect ourselves? We only have about a minute and a half left. It goes really fast here when we're on the air. But is there a way to protect ourselves from things like psychic attacks and dreams? I know poor Tim here is going to be wrapping his head in aluminum foil before he goes to bed tonight. So.
Oh, yeah.
Native American dream catcher, traditionally to catch bad dreams. If you are familiar with the idea of shielding or warding, basically erecting mental barriers for places, if we go with the idea that your mind, if you believe in something strongly enough, will make it real, it becomes very easy to manipulate energy, because all you have to do is really want to do it. Set your room and sit in the middle of your room and imagine a bubble of force going out from you and surrounding that room and becoming a barrier for things that you don't want to pass through. And be very firm in your belief, at least in the moment that you're setting it up, that this is a barrier that will not allow things to get to you that you do not want. And that is the simplest way to protect yourself. But you really do have to believe it, at least in the moment that you're putting it together.
Well,
you can question it all you want afterwards.
Sure, that makes complete sense. Well, Michelle, our time's run out on us here. I can't thank you enough for being a part of the show, and we'll have you back on here to talk about your new books that you're working on. And also, like I said, I'd like to talk to you more about the Vampire Codex once I've had a chance to go through it cover to cover and see if I can start to implement the actions in my own life and see if we can actually make a difference. So I'd love to have you back, okay?
No problem, and I do apologize to Rosemary for dodging that. We all have experiences that we're not quite ready to talk about yet.
Fully understand that. Well, thank you very much. And for those of you that had tuned in, you're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guest was Michelle Belanger, and she's the author of The Psychic Vampire Codex and also Psychic Dreamwalking. You can find links for those books. I'll be putting them up on our website, so if you need them, you can locate them there. I highly recommend you give them a look. They're interesting, insightful. And again, our good friend Rosemary Ellen Guiley, who had the question earlier and was in the chat room, has done books on vampires. It covers quite a bit, and I encourage you to check out her books as well. We'll be right back with our next guest, David Weiss, right after this.